Hello friends, welcome back to my YouTube channel Journey with Vijay Kumar Srivastava. Today I am going to present the topic Dryland Agriculture. Before presentation, little introduction about myself. I am Vijay Kumar Srivastava. I have done MS Agriculture with specialization in Agronomy from J.B. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology, Pantnagar in 1996 and presently working as a seed professional and associated with one of the MNC. Hope this presentation will be very useful to all of you. So having a request, please visit the channel, subscribe it and provide your kind and valuable feedback for further improvements in next presentations. So let's proceed to the presentation. Now we'll study the role of dryland agriculture in Indian agriculture. Indian agriculture is predominantly a rain-fed agriculture under which both dry farming and dryland agriculture are included. Out of 143 million hectares of total cultivated area in the country, 101 million hectares, around 70% area are rain-fed. The dryland area of the country contribute about 42% of total food grain production. Most of the coarse grains like sorghum, pearl millet, finger millet and other millets are grown in drylands only. The attention has been paid in the country towards the development of dryland farming. An All India Coordinated Research Project for Dryland Agriculture was launched by ICAR in 1970 in collaboration with the Government of Canada, and later Central Research Institute for Dryland Agriculture, CREDA, was established in Hyderabad. What is dryland agriculture? Growing of crops entirely under rain-fed conditions is known as dryland agriculture. Depending on the amount of rainfall received, dryland agriculture can be grouped into three categories. First one is dryland farming, second is dry farming, and third is rain-fed farming. And now we will discuss about each farming in details. Dryland farming. Dryland farming is cultivation of crops in regions with annual rainfall of more than 750 millimeters. In spite of prolonged dry spells, crop failure is relatively less frequent. These are semi-arid tracts with a growing period between 75 to 120 days. Moisture conservation practices are necessary for crop production. However, adequate drainage is required, especially for verticels. Main emphasis is on soil and water conservation, sustainable crop yields, and limited fertilizer use according to soil moisture availability. Now we will study about characteristics of dryland agriculture. It can be characterized by uncertain, ill-distributed, and limited annual rainfall. Second, occurrence of extensive climatic hazards like drought, flood, etc. Third, undulating soil surface. Fourth, occurrence of extensive and large holdings. Fifth, practice of extensive agriculture like prevalence of monocropping. Sixth, relatively large size of fields. Seventh, similarly in types of crop raised by almost all the farmers of a particular region. Eighth, very low crop yield. And ninth, poor economy of the farmers. What is dry farming? Dry farming is cultivation of crops in regions with annual rainfall of less than 750 millimeters. Crop failure is most common due to prolonged dry spells during the crop period. These are arid regions with a growing season of less than 75 days with a availability of adequate soil moisture. Moisture conservation practices are necessary for crop production. Emphasis is on soil and water conservation, sustainable crop yields, and limited fertilizer use according to soil moisture availability. What is rain-fed farming? Rain-fed farming is crop production in regions with annual rainfall of more than 1150 millimeters. Crop are not subjected to soil moisture stress during the crop period. These are humid regions with growing period of more than 120 days. Emphasis is on disposal of excess water, maximum crop yield, high level of inputs, and control of water erosion. Now to understand the difference between dryland agriculture and rain-fed agriculture. Dryland agriculture is the profitable production of useful crops without irrigation on lands in arid and semi-arid regions that receive annual rainfall of less than 750 millimeters. While rain-fed agriculture is the profitable production of useful crops without irrigation on lands which are coming in humid and sub-humid regions that receive annual rainfall of more than 750 millimeters. Now to study the difference between rain-fed and irrigated farming. First, in case of rain-fed farming, it is done in a certain period of a year where rainfall is received. While in case of irrigated farming, Throughout, crops are grown depending on the water availability. Second, in case of rainfed farming, crops and varieties are selected having the drought tolerance and having less requirement of water, while in case of irrigated farming, the crops are grown according to need as there is no constraint of irrigation. Third, in case of rainfed farming, duration of crops depends on the rainfall duration and growing period must be short duration, while in case of irrigated farming, the crops are grown depending upon the need. Fourth, in case of rainfed farming, mixed cropping is beneficial, while in case of irrigated farming, generally pure cropping is done. Fifth, due to limitations of moisture, one or two crops in a year is possible in case of rainfed farming, while in case of irrigated farming, more than two crops can be grown in a year, subjected to availability of water. Sixth, in case of rainfed farming, the field is plowed to deep to increase infiltration of rains, while in case of irrigated farming, no need for deep plowing to conserve soil moisture. Seventh, in case of rainfed farming, land is prepared immediately after rainfall, while in case of irrigated farming, land is prepared according to optimum time of sowing. Eighth, in case of rainfed farming, risk of crop failure is expected due to insufficient soil moisture or drought conditions, while in case of irrigated farming, there is no risk of crop failure. Now we will proceed to study aridity and drought. Aridity refers to a condition of deficiency of water due to either insufficient precipitation or excess water loss over supply. The term arid is derived from a Latin word arere, which means dry. Assessment of the degree of aridity of a place is necessary to serve as a base for the application of technology, for the interpretation of resource assessment, and for transfer of technology. It is also useful to analyze the climatic resources and to identify a specific climatic constraint for planning agriculture development. And what is drought? According to Ramdas, drought is a situation when the actual season rainfall is deficient by more than twice the mean deviation. American Meteorological Society defined drought as a period of abnormally dry weather sufficiently prolonged for lack of water to cause a severe hydrological imbalance in the area affected. It is the result of imbalance between soil moisture and evapotranspiration need of an area over a fairly long period as to cause damage to standing crops and to reduce the yields. The Irrigation Commission of India defines drought as a situation occurring in any area where the annual rainfall is less than 75% of normal rainfall. The difference between aridity and drought. Low rainfall or failure of monsoon rain is a recurring feature in India. This has been responsible for droughts and famines. The word drought generally denotes a scarcity of water in a region. Though aridity and drought are due to insufficient water, aridity is a permanent climatic feature and is the culmination of number of long-term processes. However, drought is a temporary condition that occurs for a short period due to deficient precipitation for vegetation, river flow, water supply, and human consumption. Drought is due to anomaly in atmospheric circulation. As difference is concerned between aridity and drought, as per duration, aridity is a permanent feature, while drought is a temporary condition of a scarcity of varying duration. If relates to factors, in case of aridity, culmination of many long-term processes considers all climatic features, while in case of drought, it is caused by deficient rainfall. If we will think about aspects description, in case of aridity, it is a description of climate, while in case of drought, this is the description of water availability. Now to study the indices of aridity, which is determined by the moisture index level. As per moisture index, the climate is classified. If moisture index level is 100 and above, it will come under perihumid climate. If moisture index is 20 to 100, it comes under humid climate. If moisture index is 0 to 20, it comes under moist subhumid climate. If moisture index level is minus 33.3 to 0, it will come under category of dry subhumid climate. If moisture index is minus 66.7 to minus 33.3, it will come under semi-arid climate. And if moisture index is minus 100 to minus 66.7, it will called arid climate. Now to study arid and semi-arid regions of India. As arid tropics climate is concerned, the area comes under this category, 31.7 million hectares area in India, and the regions are coming Rajasthan, Gujarat, Punjab, Haryana, parts of Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. If arid temperate zone is related, it is having the areas of 7 million hectares and the regions are coming Jammu and Kashmir. Third climate, semi-arid tropics, which is covering around 95.7 million hectares of country, and the regions falling under this semi-arid tropics, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Now as semi-arid temperate regions is concerned, the area is covering 1.4 million hectares of country and the regions coming under this category is Jammu and Kashmir. Now to study the improved dryland technologies. The various improved techniques and practices are recommended for achieving the objective of increased and stable crop production in dryland areas. The first one is crop planning. There it should be efficient planning according to the nature. Second is planning for weather, like considering the factor of delayed onset of monsoon. Second is long gaps or breaks in rainfall, and considering third early cessation of rains towards the end of monsoon season. So according to these conditions, we have to plan about crop cultivation. Third one is crop substitution. Fourth is cropping systems. Fifth is use of fertilizers. And sixth is rainwater management. Seventh, water shade management. And eighth is alternate land use. So these factors and techniques to be considered for cultivation of crops in dryland situation. Now we will study about factors affecting dry farming. Most of the cropping in the arid and semi-arid regions continues to be under rain-fed conditions. A majority of the farmers are small farmers with meager resources. The poor resources base permits only low input subsistence farming with low and unstable crop yields. The low productivity of agriculture in dry farming region is due to cumulative effect of many constraints for crop production. And the constraints can be broadly grouped into four groups. Like first one is climatic constraints, second is soil related constraints, third is traditional cultivation practices, and fourth is socio-economic and political constraints. Climatic constraints. These are high atmospheric temperature, low relative humidity, hot dry winds, high atmospheric water demand because of high potential evapotranspiration exceeding precipitation during most part of the year. And next, vagaries of the monsoon, which is causing variable rainfalls, intensity and distribution of rainfall, late onset of monsoon, early withdrawal of monsoon and prolonged dry spells. Now soil constraints. First one is inadequate soil moisture availability. Second, poor organic matter content of soil. Third is poor soil fertility. And fourth, soil deterioration due to erosion like wind erosion and water erosion. Now third factor affecting dry farming is traditional cultivation practices. The existing management practices adopted by the farmers are evolved based on long-term experience by the farmers. The analysis of traditional system revealed that on one hand, the traditional system suffers due to the fact that yield levels are low and unstable, while on the other hand, it has strong points due to which it has stood the test of time. The traditional management practices are listed as plowing with country plow, which is replaced by tractor now, plowing just prior to sowing, then plowing along the slope, and broadcasting seeds like guru sowing and sowing behind the country plow, leading to poor as well as uneven plant stands. Then selection of traditional varieties, monsoon sowings, choice of crops based on rainfall, application farmyard manure in limited quantity, and practice of hand weeding and mixed cropping cultivations, use of conventional system of harvesting and traditional storage system. So these are the factors which are traditionally followed, and so there is need of efficiency and modern techniques. So this was all about dryland agriculture. Now my presentation ends here. Thank you very much for your kind attention. See you again shortly. Here I have given my YouTube channel details, Journey with Vijay Kumar Srivastava. Having request, please visit the channel, subscribe it, and provide your kind and valuable feedbacks. Thank you.